Okay, I'm not going to like summarize the show or read a synopsis or anything. I'm just going to assume that you've already watched this series and you know what I'm talking about. And if you haven't, either go watch it now because I'm going to spoil it, obviously. Or if you don't care and just want to hear someone analyze the shit out of The Leftovers, just stay, I guess. All you need to know about season 3 is that Kevin is maybe Jesus, Nora is maybe crazy, and they both go to Australia. Because Nora wants to get into a machine that's going to take her to where the departed went, and Kevin wants to find his dad. This season ends with Kevin and Nora meeting up many years after the events of the third season. They now seem to be in their, like, late 50s, and Kevin is determined to get back with Nora, who vanished years ago after supposedly going to the other place by getting into this machine. Now, we don't see whether or not she actually went through with it. All we see is this. But Nora claims that she did go through with it, that she actually got into the machine and went to the other place. This other place is actually just Earth, but in a sort of parallel universe, where the departed were not the 2% of the population, but the other 98%. Nora finds her family's house and watches them from a distance and sees that they've grown up and now have lived without her for a big portion of their lives now, so she eventually decides to return to her original world by searching out the scientist who created the machine and was the first to use it. And when she got back to this world, she told Laurie not to tell anyone about all of this and she decided to live in Australia for some reason. So this is Nora's story, and all Nora wants is for Kevin to believe her. And he does. And then the show ends. So, what the fuck is going on? To better understand why this final scene is so perfect, we have to take a closer look at the two characters who appear in the scene, Kevin and Nora. So, let's talk about their relationship a little bit. In season 3, we see that Kevin and Nora's relationship is pretty toxic. They both like enable each other, and it seems like they're incapable of talking about their problems until episode 4, where they finally confront each other and everything goes to shit. It's with this relationship that we really get to see the subtleties of the writing. Like, the ways in which Kevin is completely oblivious to Nora's true intentions is portrayed in such a realistic and nuanced way.
These assholes invited me personally, so I can take them down myself.
They didn't know you were a fraud investigator?
No, they knew. They knew pretty much everything, actually.
About me?
Well, sure they do.
And they still think you're gonna get into this thing?
This scene perfectly encapsulates how honest these two characters are with each other, but how unwilling they are to deal with these issues that are most of the time blatantly obvious to both of them. They're just in denial about them and they hope they'll just go away. Another good example is in episode 2 when Nora walks in on Kevin doing his thing. She immediately tells him that it's okay and that he can do whatever he wants, and you get the strong impression that the reason she's okay with this is because she too is going down a kind of self-destructive path, and it would be hypocritical of her to judge Kevin for doing the same. It's this kind of twisted and somewhat manipulative move, and it just sums up Nora's character so perfectly. And all of this leads up to the end of episode 4, where their relationship completely crumbles. And I just love this scene so much because it really makes you believe that this is it. This relationship was never meant to be. This was never really what the show was about. The two characters finally confront each other, and honestly, this is actually the best thing they could have done at this point. These characters could not have moved on if they hadn't been completely honest with each other like this. Sure, they didn't handle it perfectly, but at least they're being genuine and forthright. They're finally saying all the things that have been bottled up for the past season. And having these characters completely explode at each other with this fire in the background, and then she lights another cigarette even though there's smoke filling up the room, it's just so perfect. Okay, now let's talk about Kevin. Whereas other characters like Kevin's dad or Matt are desperately trying to make their lives meaningful, Kevin is more interested in running away from the apparent meaning that he sees in the events he witnesses. It's almost like he's afraid that they might actually be real. Maybe he is some kind of prophet or the second coming of Christ or whatever, and there's a part of him that's almost willing to accept that, which is why he chooses to not burn the book, by the way. But he can't bring himself to accept it, because similarly to Nora, Kevin is constantly at war with his own rationality, and is many times tempted to just give in to it. Seeing as Kevin is constantly in this state of denial about the strange events that occur around him, and is unwilling to accept their supernatural nature, for good reason, seeing as they could all possibly be explained logically. The fact that season 3 creates this kind of reluctant prophet storyline for Kevin is just perfect. One of the things that Kevin has been battling with for the entire run of the series are his delusions. It's incredibly likely that Kevin suffers from some sort of mental disorder, and although unlike his father, he is willing to accept that there is clearly something wrong with him, he would also prefer, understandably, that there be another explanation, perhaps a supernatural one. So this is the conflict that's at the core of Kevin's character. He's someone who knows he's probably going insane, but is tempted to believe all these people who are telling him he isn't, who are telling him he's special. And that's one thing that the show has always been really good at, presenting these characters with situations that are so improbable that they seem supernatural, but you can still imagine a logical explanation for them. But the reason why they seem supernatural is because they hold so much meaning for the characters. The way the characters interpret these events imbues them with meaning, because they can't not see that meaning. Everything feels like a sign from God, because in a way, that's kind of what the show is about. It's about living in a world where things seem meaningful, yet you will never actually find out if they are or not. You'll never be provided with any answers to your questions. You just have to choose whether or not you're going to view these events as meaningful or not. And this is what makes Kevin's relationship with Laurie in season 2 and 3 so interesting. She's basically the only person who's willing to look at his situation rationally and tell him that he's psychotic. As a follow-up to that scene from season 2, we get season 3 episode 4, where Kevin believes he's seeing Evie in Australia, Evie being John's daughter who dies at the end of season 2. The first person Kevin calls to talk to about this is of course Laurie, because despite the fact that he believes that he saw Evie, deep down he knows that he probably didn't, that he's probably just going insane. So he calls the only person who has been willing to tell him he's crazy. Kevin spends most of the episode trying to convince her that he's not delusional and that this did happen, until this moment at the end of the episode.
I want you to listen to me. Okay, I need you to listen to me very carefully. You could have called anybody you wanted when this happened. But you called me because I think you knew that I could help you. I'm gonna give you that help now.
This scene contains so much brilliant shit, I have to take a moment to unpack all of it. So first of all, we get that little Laurie speech I showed you, which basically explains what I said earlier. Kevin is subconsciously trying to figure out whether he's going crazy or not. Then Laurie says this.
I think that you projected Evie onto a stranger. And I think you chose Evie because you understood why she did what she did, why she left her family, why she escaped. I think a part of you wants to escape, Kevin.
No, I don't want to escape.
Then why are you in Australia? It is less than a week away from the 7th anniversary, and you just ran away without telling anybody.
No, I can't be with Nora. She's the one that needed to be here. And she's the one that ran away.
Kevin, are you and Nora okay?
Kevin is a character who, like I said, is constantly trying to avoid confronting his issues because he's afraid of the answers he might find. Like, we really get the impression that Kevin is constantly running away from something. In season 2 he moves to Miracle, and in season 3 he flies to Australia, but what is he running from exactly? Well, to answer that question, I have to jump ahead to season 3 episode 7. Okay, so similar to the International Assassin episode in season 2, this episode finds Kevin returning to the other side, whatever that means. Now, most of the characters in the series, especially Matt, John, and Michael, basically see this other place as the afterlife. But the series remains ambiguous on the subject. We don't really know what this place is, literally speaking, but we know what it is in a metaphorical sense. This other world is a place where Kevin is confronted with himself. It's a place where Kevin has to deal with his problems if he wishes to return to the real world. The most interesting thing about this idea of this other place is its paradoxical nature, because this world is both an escape from the real world, yet also a place that forces Kevin to face the problems that await him in the real world. I was slightly skeptical when I realized they were doing the whole International Assassin thing again in season 3, but seeing how it turned out, I can definitely say I'm happy they decided to do it again, because at the end of the day, Kevin's issues weren't resolved in season 2. He still has things to deal with, so he needed to go back. He needed to resolve all of his issues, or at least understand them. Now, I won't go into too much detail about this because I think I could probably write an entire video on this episode alone, but I will talk about what Kevin learns from this episode, or maybe more importantly, what we learn about Kevin. Kevin goes into this supposedly for other people. His dad wants him to ask a dead Mr. Sunday to complete the rain dance thing. Grace wants Kevin to ask her children where their shoes are, and John wants Kevin to tell Evie that she was loved. But the truth is, none of these reasons are the reason why Kevin really wanted to go back to this place. And we know that, and deep down Kevin knows it too, and it's hinted at multiple times throughout the episode. So why did Kevin go back there? What did he need to do?
Well, what do you want?
I want to go home.
Do you?
What?
It's just that you've been known to say that before, and yet you keep leaving home and coming here. I'm sensing a lot of internal contradictions from you, Kevin.
So, why does Kevin keep coming back here? Well, it's simple. He just wants to run away. He doesn't want to have to deal with his problems in the real world. This world is an escape, which is why he decides to destroy it in the end, because he's decided that he doesn't want to escape anymore. He knows what he wants now, and he's not going to run away from it anymore. That's Kevin's arc throughout the entire show, and it culminates in this moment.
I think you should tell him about the book you wrote.
What book?
The romance novel. As this was clearly a national security issue, I had no choice but to procure it. Thanks.
Untitled romance novel. Chapter 1.
Just read the last page. Ending's better.
The port was alive with strange faces. It was dawn by the time he found an old salt willing to part with a vessel for what bullion he had left. A cutter with a Bermuda rig called the Merciful. Its sails ragged and ripped, its compass cracked, its rotten hull just barely able to cut the breakers. But it would be enough to make his escape. It wasn't for another hour, when he was a mile from the docks, that his thoughts turned back to her. He imagined her alone. By now, she would have searched the house and found it empty. She had suspected it all along, and now she knew. He was a coward. A coward dressed in the uniform of a brave man. Brave enough to cross two oceans and a continent to find her, to fight countless enemies, and yet, in the end, he was terrified. He was terrified of her. To lie beside her, to be comforted by her as he wept, to show her he was small, for her to know that and touch his cheek and whisper words softly into his ear. All of that was a nightmare. All he knew to do was run. He took a deep breath of the air, tasting the salt on his tongue, and closed his eyes, leaning into the spray as the Merciful picked up speed and sailed for the horizon. He was alone, and all was well. Take this thing out of me. Why? So he can't ever come back here again.
And this is where we realize what this was all about. It's about Nora. Kevin needs Nora. The answer was in his heart all along. It's a love story, and it always was.
Thank you.
Kevin needed to come back. He needed to dive back into his subconscious to get to the bottom of what it is he really wants. And he did. And now that he knows, he doesn't need this place to escape to anymore. So he destroys it. Okay, now let's talk about Nora. The dilemma that season 3 presents for Nora is honestly like one of the most interesting storylines I've ever seen in a TV show. This idea of being so determined to discover the truth and to potentially be reunited with her children, weighed against the very probable likelihood of it not actually working and that she will actually just be obliterated, is such a strong narrative conceit. It's a way of testing Nora. Is she willing to ignore her skepticism and risk death on the off chance that this may work? A great scene is when Nora is confronted with a character who's trying to convince her that this device will work, and she's trying to explain rationally to the guy why it probably won't, and that she thinks he's just suicidal. And this scene becomes brilliant when you realize that she's basically just trying to convince herself. As soon as she heard of this device, deep down, she knew she wanted to try it. She knew she was going to do it, but she's trying to logic her way out of it. I love how in this show characters go through arcs, but the arcs are usually like really subtle and like ideological. For example, in episode 2 of season 3, which is a Nora-centric episode, we start the episode with a confrontation. Nora is confronted with a woman who is lying about her husband's death. She's claiming he departed, and this annoys Nora. She's annoyed that all of these people can't see the truth and are just in denial about the whole situation. She's annoyed with their coping mechanisms, which is why she decides to print out a giant picture of the man's dead body to show everyone that he didn't depart. She's sick and tired of everyone being in denial, she just wants the truth. But Nora's desire for truth seems to be gone by the end of the season, but we'll get to that in a minute. First, I have to talk about Nora's anecdote from episode 6. So here we get Nora preparing to get into this machine, and she's talking with her brother about something that happened to them when they were children.
Do you remember when we were kids? After Mom and Dad died, when everyone at the church wouldn't take their eyes off us? They'd take us to the movies and bowling and putt-putt. Just to keep us busy?
Of course I do.
And this one time they brought us to a baseball game, and I was too young to get the rules, so I watched these people in another section hitting a beach ball. But then the ball went into the aisle, and this usher ran down and grabbed it, and he picked it up, and he just squeezed the air out of it. And then everyone started booing. Not just the people in our section, but the whole stadium booing. He just ruined it for all of them. They just wanted to hit the ball.
Now, this story very clearly tells us a lot about Nora, but you might not understand the subtext of the story if you don't understand Nora's arc. See, this story is about the rules of the game. Baseball cannot be played with a beach ball, but it made Nora happy because she didn't understand the rules of baseball. So when the beach ball came into play, that was great. Something that didn't make sense, but that made her happy. You see where I'm going with this? Nora wants to accept this thing that doesn't really make sense, this machine. She wants to believe in this beach ball shaped machine, but it doesn't follow the rules of the universe. It doesn't really make sense, but believing in it makes her happy, so she gets in. Now, let's skip to the finale, finally. What I love about the final episode is how they play around with the concept of truth. When Kevin finally finds Nora, he presents a new reality, a fake reality. He pretends as if the two had never had their entire relationship. He erased their past together so that they could start again. Understandably, Nora is somewhat shocked by this whole act. But what's interesting about this is how it sort of adds a new layer to Nora's story. Both Kevin and Nora have rewritten the past with these stories. Now, Nora doesn't accept Kevin's attempt to erase their relationship because, as she puts it, it's not true. But Kevin, on the other hand, does accept Nora's story. He believes her. The ending is ambiguous because it needs to be. If we were shown Nora going to the other place or her not going to the other place, then it would ruin the ending. It's not about whether or not what she's saying is true, it's about believing her. Because what Nora needs in this moment to be able to cope and keep on living is for someone to say, "I believe you." Because this is how Nora has chosen to cope with her grief. This is the reality she is putting forth. And the fact that Kevin is willing to say that he believes her makes that reality that much more true. Despite it probably not being true, if they can both live in denial about it and keep on living their lives basically pretending it to be true, then it kind of becomes true. And you could argue that that's wrong and that they shouldn't do that, but if it helps them live their lives, then I don't see any objection to it. Nora was too weak to go through with it, to go into the machine and to go to the other side. She realized that this extreme gamble isn't the right way to deal with her grief, so she needed something else. But by the end of the season, Nora has created her own new coping mechanism with this story that she's created for herself. Nora was always a character who was obsessed with finding the truth. She needed meaning in her life, and that was what caused her to be depressed. But by the end of the series, she's come to terms with the fact that she will never know what happened to her family, and she's replaced the truth with a story. When telling her baseball story, she asks why. Why did he have to ruin it?
Why would he want to do that job? Why would anyone?
Because if he doesn't, that ball is going to go onto the field. And it'll be fucking chaos.
By saying this, she's explaining that we can't allow people to just go around being delusional and believing things that don't make sense within the context of our universe. Essentially, it would be dangerous. But with the story that Nora has concocted for herself, she isn't harming anyone. It's basically an alternative to the device, because the device does harm people. It's dangerous. It's chaos. But this story, it's just a story. A story that makes Nora happy.